Okay, wonderful. Welcome, everyone. I'm Kirsten Kather. I teach in the Department of Asian Studies, and I'm currently the director of the Center for East Asian Studies here at UT Austin. We are so very excited to be hosting this last talk. We're finishing with a big bang here of our very, very productive year, notwithstanding all of the things we have undergone. And I do want to just take a moment to pause and thank Faith Hanley, who has, without whom we would not have accomplished any of this, much less a tenth of it. She's really, her organizational prowess and her good grace and humor has gotten us through a lot of the bumps in the road. So thank you very much to Faith. Thank you also to the Department for Asian Studies, which has been very helpful, with Lucy Ennis behind the scenes and Courtney Trammell, who have processed a lot of the, these events for us as well. I would just like to draw your attention to the chat box. For those of you who are faculty or students, graduate students here at UT, you may be interested in checking out how to join our faculty in a more formal fashion, or to how to get on listservs if you're interested in events. Please follow that link. So again, it is my delight to introduce our speaker today, Taomo Zhou. Just very briefly, we're really thankful that she can be here. I would also flag that she's speaking to us from Singapore, which I believe it's 5 in the morning there, maybe 4. God, I'm sorry. So we're at cocktail hour. She's at pre-coffee time, but we will meet in the middle here and have a wonderful talk. I'd like to really thank the Julian Soas Endowment in Chinese Studies, which funded this event, and also Professor Madeline Xu in history, who so generously organized and proposed the entire thing. So I'll hand it over to Dr. Xu now, who will introduce our speaker, who will talk for about 30 minutes, and then we hope to have a vigorous 30-minute question A and be out at 5 p.m. happy hour time for those of us in Austin. Dr. Xu, please, Madeline.
Thank you, Professor Cather. I'm so delighted to have this opportunity to welcome Professor Taomo Zhou to speak to our UT community. She is the author of this wonderful book, Migration in the Time of Revolution, China, Indonesia, and the Cold War, which has just received an honorable mention for the Harry J. Bender Prize from the Association for Asian Studies. And I think this is a reflection of just sort of, I think this is going to be a very influential study. She draws on archives from 3 different countries, Indonesia, China, and Taiwan, and really provides a complicated and nuanced tracking of the processes of decolonization and international relations in this region, particularly with its impact on sort of the Chinese population in Indonesia, whose national placing, whose sort of the problems of boundary making are actually, in, you could say, in many ways still unresolved, right? But Professor Zhou's work really shows us many of these difficult dynamics during the 50s and 60s. She is an assistant professor at Nanyang Technological University in Singapore. She received her PhD from, Cornell University. Okay, sorry, Cornell University. She is a graduate of Peking University. Her next projects, which you can ask about, which just to me sound fascinating, concern her home city of Shenzhen in China. She's also working on different aspects of the Cold War in Southeast Asia. This is really critical scholarship. She is a co-principal investigator for the project Literary Representations of the Cold War, a comparative study of Singapore, Malaysia, and Indonesia. She also is a collaborator for the project Reconceptualizing the Cold War on the Ground Experiences in Asia. And so this is a really burgeoning field in Asian studies. I think we are very fortunate to have Professor Zhou here to speak to us today.
Thank you so much, Madeline, for the generous introduction. So I'm going to share my screen now. Can everyone see it all right? Okay. Thank you so much, Professor Xu, for the generous introduction. Thank you so much, Professor Carter, for hosting me. And thank you so much, Faith, for the logistic support. And thanks to everyone for joining us on Friday evening. So I'm going to start my talk by zooming into a day during my fieldwork in May 2013. At the time, I was in the port city of Surabaya in East Java, Indonesia. There, I met Mr. Wong Deyong, the gentleman you see in the picture here standing in the middle. He is a third generation ethnic Chinese. As required by 1966 legislation, all Chinese had to adopt Indonesian sounding names. Mr. Wong changed his name to Uncle. Mr. Uncle's father worked for a political organization founded by the Indonesian Chinese descent called Baperki. He was shot dead by the Indonesian military during a search of his home. Mr. Uncle was 15 years old at the time of his father's murder. He described the atmosphere during those days. Here I quote him. There were beheaded bodies dumped on the streets. The chop off heads were displayed on the bridges. More bodies were dumped into the river. The color of the river turned red because it's full of blood. Mr. Onko's father was killed during what some scholars call Indonesia's forgotten genocide. In recent years, this tragedy has been brought to the attention to Western audience through two award-winning documentaries, The Act of Killing and The Look of Silence. The mass violence was triggered by the September 30th movement in 1965. This probably is the most important and the most mysterious event of modern Indonesian history. Before dawn on October 1st, 1965, a small group of left-leaning soldiers from the Indonesian army abducted and later killed six senior anti-communist generals. So here we see the statues of the generals. This picture is and ones in the following three slides are all taken at a place called the Secret Pancasila Museum in Jakarta. It was the original headquarters of the coup initiators, later Soeharto transformed it into a national memorial site. The kidnappers claimed that they did so to preemptively strike against a CIA-sponsored intrigue targeting the Indonesian president Soekarno, the person you see on your right. However, the next day, Soeharto, the person you see on the left, who was at the time the head of the Indonesian Army's strategic reserve, initiated an effective counterattack. Soeharto characterized the event as a coup d'etat by the Indonesian Communist Party, which was at the time the third largest Communist Party in the entire world. Soeharto and the Indonesian army under him alleged that half-naked members of the women's wing of the Communist Party called Gowani mutilated the lifeless bodies of the generals before their male counterparts dumped the corpses into a dried well called the crocodile hole. This kind of propaganda dehumanized participants in the left-wing movement, which was a very important step in the social mobilization for a nationwide anti-communist campaign. The campaign escalated into one of the worst mass murders of the 20th century, comparable to the mass violence that occurred in Bosnia, Cambodia, and Rwanda. In a little over 6 months, an estimated 500,000 people affiliated to the Indonesian Communist Party were killed. In his recent book, The Jakarta Method, journalist Vincent Belvins argues that Indonesia became the model for authoritarian violence in faraway countries such as Argentina and Chile. In the streets of Latin America, graffiti of "The Jakarta is coming" appeared in the late 1960s. Local military rulers copied the same technique of mass disappearance from Indonesia to wipe out left-wing organizations in a genocidal fashion. After 1965, almost overnight, Indonesia, which is the fourth most populous country on earth, went from being a fierce voice for anti-imperialism and an important ally of the People's Republic of China, or PRC, to a compliant partner of the US world order. The Suharto government made aggressive charges against the Chinese Communist Party for exporting revolution abroad. This idea was instilled in the minds of the general Indonesian population through the film The Betrayal of the Indonesian Communist Party, a propaganda tool of the Suharto regime that was broadcast annually on the evening of September 30th. In the film, Chinese doctors were shown practicing acupuncture with electric shock on President Sukarno, and their diagnosis of Sukarno's health condition as critically dangerous is presented as the trigger for the Indonesian communist coup attempt. This propaganda implicated ethnic Chinese in Indonesia, who number around 2.5 million at a time. At a Quanshan overseas Chinese farm in Fujian province of China, I interviewed Mr. Li Peinan, the gentleman standing in the middle with the green shirt. Mr. Li is a second generation ethnic Chinese from Aceh. Mr. Li's elder brother worked for the youth wing of the Indonesian Communist Party, which is called Pemuda Rakyat. He was captured and murdered by the local military authority. More than 1,000 local Chinese were forced by anti-communist vigilante groups to stand under the tropical sun with black paint poured over their head and RRT, an insulting acronym that meant Republic Rakyat China, the People's Republic of China, painted on their backs. I want to emphasize here that the Indonesian mass killings of 1965 and 66 was not an ethnic cleansing of the ethnic Chinese. Most victims were members or sympathizers of the Indonesian Communist Party. They were targeted due to ideological reasons, not because of their ethnicity. But overall, the Chinese Indonesia, regardless of their political affiliation, experienced a period of insecurity in 1965 and 1966. Many ethnic Chinese were harassed, imprisoned, or deprived of their property and expelled from Indonesia. Moreover, the idea that the ethnic Chinese were guilty by association of a communist coup d'etat justified long-term state-led discrimination. Under Suharto's three-decade rule, the ethnic Chinese were given a special designation on their ID cards. Chinese language education was banned, and they were coerced into changing their names. In the image on your left-hand side, we see an art installation called Writing in the Rain by Chinese Indonesian artist F.X. Harsono. Harsono is writing with a brush, the only three Chinese characters he knows, which is Hu Fengwen, as those of you who read Chinese can tell his name in Chinese. But as he writes, water starts pouring down and washing away the ink, symbolizing the erasure of the history and culture of Chinese Indonesians. My book tries to answer two questions. First and foremost, did Beijing instigate the Indonesian Communist Party to usurp state power by force? Second, was the hostility against the ethnic Chinese a fitting retribution for Beijing's attempt to engineer a communist coup in Indonesia? I will talk about how I collect materials to answer these two questions. I obtained Chinese governmental records during a brief window of opportunity. Between 2006 and 2008, the Chinese Foreign Ministry archives declassified thousands of documents. However, this collection was reclassified in 2013. In addition to this body of currently unavailable official records in Beijing, I have drawn on the Indonesian National Archives in Jakarta, Academia Historica in Taipei. I also conducted oral history interviews. So on the left, you see former political prisoners staging a weekly protest in front of the presidential palace in Jakarta. No matter rain or shine, they hold black umbrellas as a sign of protest. In the middle, you see Mr. Tan Sui Ling, an ethnic Chinese activist imprisoned during Suharto's rule. And on the right, you see Mr. Nano, who studied architecture in Tsinghua University in Beijing, and he's the son of the former culture attaché Indonesian cultural attaché to China. I also visited 5 overseas Chinese farms. So what is an overseas Chinese farm? It's like an enclave where the ethnic Chinese who migrated to the PRC from abroad were given virgin land on which to rebuild their lives. I also interviewed Indonesian political exiles who sought refuge in China. They were sheltered by the International Liaison Department of the Chinese Communist Party, or Zhongliangbu. The exiles were settled in a clandestine compound with the codename 510 in the landlocked Jiangxi province of China. So I'm going to summarize my findings. Available evidence reveals that most likely the Indonesian Communist Party leader Idit, the person you see in the picture here on the left holding hands with Mao Zedong, he independently designed the September 30th movement. Top Chinese leaders have prior knowledge of Idit's scheme, but the swift execution of the plan probably took them by surprise. In his meeting with Mao Zedong in August 1965, Idit sketched out what he would do in a political scenario without the most important supporter of the Indonesian Communist Party, which is President Sukarno. The strategies Idit shared with Mao bear a strong resemblance to what actually happened on October the 1st. My findings corroborated with the earlier work by Professor John Rusa based on Indonesian sources. Although the Indonesian and Chinese communists had shared interests, existing evidence suggests that Beijing's role in the political development in Indonesia in 1965 was likely to be insubstantial. The Indonesian army, as shown in the microfilm image of its newspaper Angkatan Bersenjata, made accusations that Beijing had smuggled arms to Indonesia for a communist revolt. This idea was also spread in Western popular culture through the film The Year of Living Dangerously. Here is a screenshot in which a British intelligence officer in Jakarta, played by Sigourney Weaver, is telling her lover, an Australian journalist, played by Mel Gibson, that weapons from Shanghai has arrived in Jakarta. The Chinese leaders did offer small arms to Indonesia, but the deal was made on an official state-to-state level rather than party-to-party level. And the weapons probably had not arrived prior to October 1st, 1965. Moreover, Chinese military aid to Indonesia lagged far behind the aid given by the Soviet Union and the United States. Newly declassified US state documents revealed that American diplomats in Jakarta had considered accusations of PRC involvement in Indonesia to be a hoax. However, the US encouraged the spread of the fake news. In the early 1960s, Beijing and Jakarta forged an anti-imperialist partnership. Beijing's first priority was to befriend Indonesia as part of an international united front that was independent from both the Soviet Union and the United States. Based on the available evidence, it will be fair to conclude that instigating the Indonesian Communist Party to overthrow the friendly left-leaning government led by President Sukarno would not suit Beijing's best interests. So the image here captured the signing of the Sino-Indonesian Dual Nationality Treaty in 1955. Through this treaty, Beijing ceased to automatically recognize all persons with Chinese blood as PRC citizens and encouraged them to take Indonesian citizenship and integrate into the Indonesian society. The PRC foreign policymakers, under the leadership of the savvy Premier Zhou Enlai, concluded that the first step for Beijing to expand its influence in Southeast Asia should be dispelling local government's fear for the ethnic Chinese, serving as a vehicle for the PRC's ambition for regional dominance. Through the signing of the Sino-Indonesian Dual Nationality Treaty, the PRC tried to draw a clear line between overseas Chinese affairs and state-to-state diplomacy. However, the political demobilization of the diaspora is not like an easy process of turning off a switch. The Chinese community in Indonesia was divided along the battle lines of the Chinese Civil War, which was fought between the communist and nationalist parties. The nationalists had a longer history of activism in Indonesia and managed to penetrate the overseas society there more deeply. after its retreat to Taiwan in 1949, the Chinese Nationalist Party regarded overseas Chinese as an important source of support for its mission to recover the motherland and reclaim its political legitimacy. So on your left, we see a picture of Chiang Kai-shek and Soh Mei-ling with an overseas Chinese basketball team from Indonesia. The picture was taken in 1953. As you can see, all the basketball players are wearing Indonesian batik. The communists, on the other hand, were a latecomer compared to its nationalist rivals. They built its support base among the overseas Chinese through the publishing and education efforts of a group of left-wing intellectuals who traveled from mainland China to Southeast Asia during the Second World War. A representative figure is Baran, a well-known writer of his time. He lived in Sumatra for more than 5 years in the late 1940s before he became the PRC's first ambassador to Indonesia. So in the image on your right, you see him. He's the gentleman standing in the middle with the beard, and he was standing among Chinese language school teachers in North Sumatra. Baran was particularly skillful in youth mobilization. These young people assisted the CCP, the Chinese Communist Party, in establishing underground offices in Sumatra, which were hidden behind the counters of pastry shops, Chinese medicine companies, soap factories, and wineries. Initially incited by the Nationalist and Communist parties, the rivalry between the pro-Taiwan, pro-Beijing Chinese Indonesia later took form specific to the diasporic society and had gained an unforeseen momentum that neither Taipei or Beijing could control. Throughout the 1950s, the Beijing versus Taipei rivalry bifurcated Chinese language media, schools, and civic associations. Children from pro-Beijing schools were called red butts or hong pigu by the pro-Taipei students, whereas children from the pro-Taipei schools were called blue butts or lan pigu by the pro-Beijing students, and they will fight in the streets. Both sides claimed that all ethnic Chinese own their political loyalty to China's sole legitimate center, Beijing according to the communists or Taipei according to the nationalists. After 1949, many ethnic Chinese experienced the establishment of the PRC as a moment of national pride and elevation of social status. On October the 1st, in the early years of 1950s, on October the 1st every year, the pro-Beijing Chinese would organize PRC National Day celebrations in major Indonesian cities. Although the majority of these celebrations were grassroots initiatives, some political elites in Indonesia regarded these activities as Beijing-directed encroachment on Indonesian sovereignty. By the late 1950s, the pro-Beijing faction had become much more influential in the Chinese community in Indonesia. But the political activism of the pro-Beijing faction aroused suspicions from Indonesian government, aggravated ethnic tension in the Indonesian society, and destabilized governmental relations between Beijing and Jakarta. Moreover, despite Beijing's redefinition of citizenship on legal terms, its transnational circulation networks remain very active. Throughout the 1950s, Indonesian authorities made several abortive attempts to curb the inflow of textbooks, films, music, and print media from the PRC. Meanwhile, the ties between the PRC diplomatic mission in Indonesia and the local diasporic society remain extremely close. So starting from 1962, the domestic politics and foreign policy of both China and Indonesia took a turn further to the left. The PRC's social infrastructure of overseas mobilization helped synchronize the communal life of the Chinese Indonesians with Beijing. In late 1965 and 1966, the export of Cultural Revolution texts and songs fueled the radicalization of diasporic politics. For instance, the famous song, "Sailing the Sea Depends on the Helmsman," 大海航行靠舵手, was translated into Bahasa Indonesia and widely circulated. In 1966, Radio Beijing also started to include quotations from Chairman Mao in its special program for the Chinese diaspora. In the heat of the Cultural Revolution, the PRC violated its previous principle of discouraging ethnic Chinese who had become Indonesian citizens from participating in Beijing-oriented politics. Although Beijing's actual role in the September 30th movement was very limited, its reckless handling of overseas Chinese affairs ironically assisted Suharto's propaganda, which incriminated the PRC and the Chinese Indonesians. In 1965 and 66, attacks on the PRC embassy, consulates, and news agencies all across Indonesia were rampant. Some of these attacks were funded by the Chinese nationalist government as the anti-communist forces in Taiwan and Indonesia joined hands. The PRC embassy staff invented self-defense strategies using beer bottles, light bulbs, and Chinese martial art. In order to block the Indonesian army and right-wing youth from taking hold of the PRC flag, a symbol of national pride, Chinese embassy staff secured it with iron chains and applied automobile oil to the flagpole to make it too slippery for anyone to climb up. When trying to protect the national flag, a PRC diplomat named Zhao Xiaoshou was shot in the lungs. He survived the injury and was later lauded as a red diplomatic fighter. The image of an injured Zhao being carried on a stretcher towards the airplane for medical evacuation became a media sensation in the early stage of the Cultural Revolution. Diplomatic relations between China and Indonesia were suspended in 1967 and remained so until the end of the Cold War. I'd like to summarize with discussions about three broader thematic issues. The first is about race and class. The recent blockbuster Crazy Rich Asians juxtaposes stereotypes of Chinese Americans and Southeast Asian Chinese, whereas the Chinese Americans were often perceived as predominantly working class. They were so-called co-ethnics in Southeast Asia are commonly viewed as capitalists or Jews of the East. It's not unusual for them to be blamed as the source of social inequality and corruption. Barron, the first PRC ambassador to Indonesia, concluded that racialized violence against the Chinese was a class rather than ethnic issue. It was the working class indigenous groups' rebellion and retaliation against the Chinese capitalists. Barron believed, quote unquote, class struggle will break down the stone wall between different ethnic groups. But in the context of the Cold War, this vision of transnational class solidarity only complicated the dilemma faced by the Chinese Indonesians, making their so-called foreign origin even more suspicious. They became a symbol of both capitalist exploitation and communist infiltration. The second theme I like to discuss is about socialism and capitalism. Ironically, the pro-Chinese communist groups in Indonesia gained greater control over the diasporic society through collaboration with local businessmen, as well as their own engagement in capitalist economy. During World War II, the founding members of the Chinese Communist Party underground branches in Indonesia opened a chain of pastry factories to generate income. The success of their cake business gave the Chinese Communist Party cadres in Indonesia the confidence to build more comprehensive modern enterprises. The PRC in the 1950s and 60s saw a great opportunity to accumulate foreign exchange through the overseas Chinese remittance networks. Beijing also sought to reserve, quote unquote, a special niche of state capitalism, in the words of Professor Glenn Peterson, for the overseas Chinese entrepreneurs by linking their investments directly to the state's industrial priorities. However, the majority of Southeast Asian Chinese who migrated to the PRC during this period started their lives all over again on the overseas Chinese farms in the mountainous regions in southern China. For those who used to engage in commerce, their skills and talents in private business were incompatible with the planned economy. Their unfamiliarity with manual labor, their love for music and art, even their habit of taking daily showers were labeled as bourgeois and regard it as politically incorrect. These migrants, however, carry with them the daily practices of capitalism and connections to worldwide circulation of capital. During my fieldwork at Indo Overseas Chinese Farm in Guangdong, I was introduced to a pak lambu. So lambu in Bahasa Indonesia means sticky rice cake. So the gentleman you see here in the picture, he was exactly known for the Indonesian sticky rice cake. He made and sold to the local community in the 1960s and early 1970s. Keep in mind that this is a time when having a personal small business was a punishable offense in China. Paradoxically, the economic autonomy of returned overseas Chinese like Pak Lambu helped prepare coastal South China for the reform and the opening that started in the late 1970s. My last point is about diaspora and diplomacy. So Professor Matt Winshi's Good Immigrants is a nuanced study on the dynamic and inextricable relationship between immigration issues, foreign diplomacy, international agendas, competing racial ideologies, and economic prerogative. It is a source of inspiration for this book, which aspires to be a reinterpretation of diaspora politics, ethnic conflicts, and international relations in an integrated and interactive framework. I hope to reconstruct the experiences of China and Indonesia in the Cold War as part of a cross-Asia transnational social history. Even though China and Indonesia do not share geographic borders, the existence of 2.5 million ethnic Chinese Indonesia, many of whom had economic influence but an unclear citizenship status, give rise to a porous social frontier. In 1950, the PRC used the stage at Bandung Conference to declare that it recognized territorial boundedness triumph over trans-border ties of common ethnicity or ideology. However, ethnic conflicts continue to intersect with international politics. Migrant disputes disrupted geostrategic collaborations. I hope the book can open up more discussions about how in the process of decolonization, newly independent nations interacted with one another when citizenship was contested, political loyalty was in question, identity was fluid, and the boundaries for political mobilization was blurred. The overseas Chinese war and still are a very important but highly controversial resource for the PRC's advancement of political and economic interests abroad. During the Cold War and in the so-called new Cold War between China and the United States today, Chineseness is constantly manipulated or mobilized by political actors for political gains. I hope the history I presented today will help us better understand racial politics in the age of pandemic and contemporary anxieties and concern over China's influence, interference, or infiltration through Chinese diaspora worldwide. Thank you, and I look forward to the discussion.